spoken. He's just going to play prelude. So if you guys want to talk amongst each other, you can. Test. Just stand back by the flower, it'll be fine. Thank you.
Maybe this thing would be big enough to cover my face up. I'm Dennis Axton. I was a friend of Jim's, and he asked me a few days before he passed away if I would do this. It's kind of a challenge, both emotionally and in any other way. We just had a bagpipe rendition of a few songs, and none of which I recognize, so I won't explain what they are. We'll start out with a musical selection of Amazing Grace, after which my wife Susan Saxton will give an opening prayer, and then I'll do a life sketch after that, and we'll go to that point.
Our dearest Father in heaven, we come before thee this morning in an attitude of gratitude for this wonderful man that we loved, and grateful unto thee for having the opportunity to know and love him. And we pray today, Father, for thy Holy Spirit and Comforter to be with this wonderful family, to help them all to feel thy love, to feel Jim's love, and know that he is watching over all of them. We are grateful for this beautiful world that we live in, and we know that there is much unrest, but we know that there is much love and peace if we just trust in thee. And we ask thee, Father, to please again be with this service this day, that everyone that's here will feel of thy spirit and love and comfort. And we ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
James Neltson McCullough, Jim, was born June 11th, 1946 in Ontario, Oregon, to James and Helen McCullough. Jim passed away Tuesday, April 21st, 2020 at a hospital in Meridian at St. Luke's. Jim was reared and educated in Payette, Idaho, where he graduated in 1964. Jim was a rancher like his father and grandfather. He spent most of his childhood and younger adult years on the family ranch at Paddock by Little Willow Creek outside Payette, Idaho. He was a very skilled horseman and roper. There really wasn't much he couldn't do with a horse and the cattle. It was pretty remote on the ranch. The power came from a generator that Jim was always out repairing to get power restored. 2 years after graduation, Jim married Sharon Hanson on July 15, 1966. Together, they moved to Boise, where Jim worked in several jobs before taking on a career in truck driving. Their daughter, Rhonna, was born in 1968. The family moved to Buhl, where he worked for a year, and then returned to driving truck with another move back to Payette. Their son, James, was born in 1973. In 1985, Jim and Sharon divorced. Jim found new employment with Image National Sign until he retired in 1997. He married Ellen Keith on October 1st, 1994 in Elko, Nevada. They lived together in Emmett since 1997. Jim is survived by his wife, Ellen of Emmett, daughter, Rhonna, and Randy Powell of Nampa, son, James J. McCullough and Deanna of Caldwell, stepchildren, Lisa Stover and Kip of Meridian, Carrie Moss of Meridian, John Jackson of Meridian, Christine Jackson Barber, and Scott of Seattle, Washington, 5 grandchildren, 2 great-grandchildren, 3 sisters, Janet Toll of Caldwell, Christine Friend of Boise, and Margaret McCullough of Emmett. I became acquainted with Jim initially as a church assignment to watch over the family and to be aware of their needs. That's how it started out, and I'm not good at any of those kinds of things, but I've gained most of my friends from those types of assignments. And my wife can tell you that it's hard to even blow me out of the house with dynamite, so I kind of hover around there. But as I had time to share with Jim and be around him a lot, we came into a close friendship. And it was convenient because he drove by my house virtually every day. He took Jerry to work, so if I had extra veggies in the garden, which I frequently did, and begging people to come and get them was a hard job. So I just give him a call when I figured about when Jerry was coming home from work and asking to drop by and help me out. JJ gave me some of his memories. It's interesting because in talking to Jim, I never knew whether he was a truck driver or an electrician, and I found out it was both. So I come to an understanding, and that's why I like about funerals. I learn about people things I don't know. The thing that I will remember most about my father was he could do just about anything. If it had tires, he could drive it. If it had feet, he could ride it. I remember deer hunting with my father and my cousin, and my cousin and I shot a couple of deer in a really ugly spot. We were able to get my deer out with a lot of work, but could not get his out. So we loaded my deer on a horse and off to camp we went. When we got back and explained that we had another one that was in a real bad spot, we all saddled up and went to get it. When we got to the top of the hill and showed everyone the area the deer was, we all tied off horses and started to climb down. Well, except Dad. He rode his horse downhill with it sliding and dragging its butt on the ground, and sure enough, he was able to ride into that spot to all of our amazement. But to him, just another day on the horse. Now, I didn't hear the ending of this, how he got the horse back out with the deer. I guess that's another story to be told at another time. My father was also very good on a motorcycle. There was a hill out past where we grew up called the Face. All the locals called it the Suicide because of how nasty steep this hill was. I had never seen anyone climb it until one day out riding, my dad decided he was going to climb it We all said no, no way, Pops, but he tried it anyway, and he climbed that sucker. That is a couple of stories that he remembered. We started out by taking Jerry to church. That was initially how we got started, but I'd stop in the driveway and talk to Jim every now and again, and pretty soon we became good friends. And of course, my veggies helped a little bit on that. I love to garden. That's where you usually find me. And so, and I always had extra, because I garden because I love to do it, not because I necessarily eat all I do. And so I always like good friends around to share. And Jim was very capable of helping me out there. Over time, we grew really close. Some of you I just had a chance the last couple days to meet, but I think I kind of knew you long before, because Jim and I swapped stories about his children and my children, and I knew about the little sweetheart Mason who I knew practically every time she was going to perform and how well she was doing and just exactly what was going on. And I heard stories about all the rest too. I knew that he loved his children, that he thought very highly of them, but he wasn't selfish. I have a little grandson that he was 2.5. They diagnosed him, or 3.5. They diagnosed him with leukemia. And so Jim was always interested in how Sam was doing. And every time he dropped by, he wanted to know how Sam was doing. And I had a son that served in Iraq, and he was always interested in how things were going for him, and different ones of my children. He knew about them. Jerry knows them better than anybody. And Jerry always told Jim, and then Jim would come and check up to find out what was going on. And he was always interested in my family. I knew that he had a big heart, that he loved all of his children, and that he loved his wife, and that he loved Jerry. And when one day in the church, we divide borders from time to time, and one day they divided the borders, and it meant that Jim and Jerry were in a different ward than I was in, and that upset Jim. He called me and says, "That can't happen." He says, if Jerry's not with you, she won't go to church." He was so concerned about Jerry and somebody that would take care of her, like he knew that I would. And I said, "It's okay, Jim. I've talked to a few people, and we got something going on the way." And pretty soon, we got the records moved out of the area, but into our ward where I could. And I promised the bishop that I'd take care of her till I died if it was necessary. But I knew it was important to Jim. And toward the last, I know some people got a little disturbed toward the last that we weren't able to share Jim as much. I want to express to you, it kind of hit us by surprise, and we weren't ready for it either. And the first time, about 3 weeks ago, they asked if I would drive him over to a doctor's appointment. But Ellen knew it was much worse than that. We went into the doctor's appointment, and the doctor was just going to shove him out the door after he'd done whatever he'd done. And Ellen says, "No, we can't take him home. You've got to check him." "Well, that's not what we had scheduled." And she says, "He's got to have more attention than that." And Ellen was the one that made sure that we stayed there until they would take him. And it turns out he had pneumonia, and he had an infection that went into his blood. And so they says, "Yeah, you got to get him over to the emergency room." Well, they weren't too kind to us. We sat out in the parking lot for 4 hours because they wouldn't let us in, trying to figure out whether we were leaving him there or whether we were waiting to take him home or whatever. But finally, they told us that they were keeping him. So for a couple of days, he stayed there. Now, I'm a little remiss because Jim, as Jim would, decided he was coming home. He wasn't staying in the hospital, and I wished he would have stayed. I think they could have helped him a little more. I don't know if that would have been successful, but I feel like that it might have. He came home, and he just steadily got worse. Till finally, I believe it was Saturday, a week ago Saturday, that Ellen called me up. Well, first of all, I went and talked to Jim because we were headed to the grocery store, and we stopped in, and he asked for a blessing, and I gave him a blessing. And I felt that the Lord wanted Jim to know that he loved him, that, you know, not to fear what would happen, because he loves him. He knows his heart. He knows that he spent a lot of years taking care of Ellen and Jerry through some pretty significant issues, and and that he stayed with it, that he stuck to it, and that it was a challenge for him because his health was not extremely well either, but he wasn't thinking about his health. He was thinking about people that he had a responsibility to. And I knew that he that his heart was really good and that the Lord loved him because of all the things he'd done. And I felt prompted to tell him that, that the Lord loved him and that his mission may be, in fact, done in this life, and that it was okay. It was okay. The Lord would welcome him home with open arms if that was the situation. And when I finished, I don't know everything I said. I said what came to my heart. And but I know when I finished, Jim says, I feel better. And so we didn't know at that point. I mean, he wasn't feeling good. But by that night at 10 o'clock, Ellen gave me a call, she needed help. And I realized when we got done with that little situation there that Jim couldn't talk very much. It took all he could do to breathe, and talking or eating or anything else was just too much for him. And I think, well, I don't know if we overprotected him, but I know it was just such an effort. Sometimes without my hearing aids, I couldn't hear him. He couldn't talk very loud, and it was all he could do to push enough air through to get something out. And I told Ellen, I says, we got to do something. I said, if he has another emergency, I said, you and I can't get him where he needs to be. And so that's when we called the emergency and had them come. And of course, that was the last I got to see of Jim that night. I'm grateful for the friendship that we had. I'm a little overwhelmed that he thought enough of it to ask me. That was one of the things when I gave him the blessing, as he asked me to do this. And I told him I would, reluctantly, because I'm not big at standing. I can talk one-on-one, but I'm not as big and stand in front of a lot of people. But I knew it was important to him. And when I said I'd do it, then I felt him relax. And so it's a favor to him. I can tell you one thing. I've done a lot of reading and studying, and if it's true, some people have talked about the spirit hanging around till the body's finally tucked away. And some ways, last night when I was thinking about this, I think that Jim may be amongst us right now. He may be there comforting you. He'll be a blessing to you, and as our Father in heaven allows him, from time to time, he may come and put his arm around you. I know that that's happened in our family. I lost a daughter 28 years ago in a car accident, and here last year, a granddaughter was taking care of our house, and she was feeling quite lonely and overwhelmed, and one night she felt her presence and told her that she'd been there for the family all summer long, and I really do believe that that happens. I really did. We know that Jim's body has been laid to rest, but his spirit has always been alive. Jim and I had this discussion. I said, Jim, you know that you lived before you came to the earth, right? And he says, yes, I do. I says, you know, we came for a mortal experience, and a lot of us are going to make mistakes, okay? That's the natural experience that we have in this life, is that we're going to make mistakes, and some of them are not going to be too pretty, and some of them, I know I've made some that I'm not very proud of, and I wished it never happened, and I know that we all do. But we also talked about Christ and what his mission was, that he came and he suffered for all that to fix it all up. And I know that when Jim stepped across that veil, that Christ welcomed him with love, and he didn't judge him. He smiled, and Jim knew what he'd done, and Christ knows what he'd done. But that's what he done, is to patch all that up. That was his whole intent, is to come here and fix problems for all of us. And he loved him, and he loves all of you. I want you to know that. He loves every one of you. And as he needs to, and as he feels prompted to, he'll allow Jim to come and put his arm around you and comfort you and bless you. Jim loved all of you. I know he did. I heard many of your names before ever I met you, and I had to figure out which ones fit where, but I know that he loved you, and I know that Christ loves you. I know that there's a plan for all of us, and I know that we all come here, and sometimes we rub each other wrong, and sometimes we please each other, and we do all kinds of things. But if we can put away the past, because Christ has forgiven us all, I just want to bring one other little moment to you. one day a bunch of guys with a wrong attitude brought a woman and brought her before Christ, and they'd caught her in the very act of adultery. And they told him that the law says that we should stone her. And he says, what do you think? And Christ just kind of sat there, and they were kind of antsy, and they wanted an answer because they thought they could trap him. And he finally stood up, and he looked them in the eyes, and he said, he who was without sin cast the first stone. And then he bent down and started scribbling on the ground. And when he looked up, nobody was there. And he says, woman, where art thou thy accusers? And she says, no man accuseth me, Lord. And he says, neither do I. Go your way and sin no more. He loves us all. He knows we're going to make mistakes. He's there to cover. And he doesn't accuse us. The accuser is Satan, not Christ. He loves us all. And when we all go, we will find his arms open and welcoming and loving us. And we'll fix the problems when we get over there. He's already got the plan. It's already fixed. It's just our time to love one another and to forgive and forget. And I'm grateful for a Savior because I need it. Above anybody else, I need it. And I'm grateful for that. And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, we're going to have a moment for those of you who want to come up, and they've asked us to come up in the microphone because it's being streamed. Okay, so if you have a few memories that you would like to share about Jim, we invite you to come up and do that. And then we'll when you're done doing that, then I'll announce the rest of the end of it.
What I really miss about him, he cared every morning. He called me. He wanted to know if I was doing okay and all that stuff. And I didn't miss him. He always called me, wanted his paw every day morning. And he always wanted his candy. And stuff. I knew what he wanted. When I got the telephone, I think it was my brother letting me know he was gonna pass away. I really think that. I think he's in his cage right there.
I guess I'm here, so. Just a couple fun little stories about my dad growing up. He bought me my first horse, and this horse was just awful. It was short little Shetland paint pony that was just mean as can be. And he'd put me on that horse, and every time that horse would just buck me off. And he'd tell me to, you know, I'd be crying, and he'd get back on that horse. Get back on the horse, it'd buck me off again. Finally, I got bucked off again, and I went crying to my grandma. And grandma told me I didn't have to get back on the horse. And dad said, yes, she's got to get back on the horse. And she said, you get on the horse. Well, he got on the horse, and it bucked him off. Then the horse was gone. So, yeah. That's just a really fun memory that I have with him. And, you know, like JJ said in, that Dennis was talking about in the obituary, that there was really nothing that he couldn't ride or drive. I wasn't even born yet when he had a job in Boise. And they came to him and wanted him to, they said, Jim, can you drive a truck? And he lied and said, yeah, I can drive a semi. Well, we need this load in, and I think it was like Salt Lake. And so he got in the truck and took him a couple hundred miles, grinded all the gears, but he learned to drive a truck, and then he was a truck driver. So those are just some fun little memories that I have of my dad.
most of you know me as Gary Toll, Jen's husband and Jen's brother-in-law. I want to tell a little story about him. You know, we all make mistakes. Sometimes they're mistakes, but they are good memories. And I remember one year, it was a birthday party. I can't remember now whose birthday it was. And who was it? Our son. And Brother Jim and I went out and shot some pool. And we kept winning the pool game, and they played a little longer, played a little longer. We were late to the birthday party. That was bad enough, but that wasn't all of the story. Somehow, for some reason, we were kind of squirrely and felt frisky, and I can't remember who even started it, but there was some butter in the kitchen, and it was our house in Napa. And next thing I knew, someone had butter, and then we had a butter fight. All over the house there was butter. Jan had butter on her. We all had butter on us, but it was just one of those riotous times, and I remember that as a real chuckle. But Jim and I did do a little more drinking than we should have, but we survived it, and we were blessed to have fellowship with Jim. So that's about all I have. Thank you.
Yeah, my brother Jim and I, we had a lot of fun as kids growing up. He always used to have fairly long hair, and I used to pull it to get even with him. And one day he went to the barber with Dad, and he told the barber, he says, "I want you to cut my hair just as short as you can get it so my sister can't pull it." That was one of them as a kid. We used to always shovel the snow out in the driveway. Had a lot of fun shoveling the driveway we didn't have, but it was fun. Then as we grew up, we all made mistakes. But sometimes those mistakes we had a lot of fun with. One night we was downtown partying, and my dad, my brother, and I, when we partied, we partied. We'd leave the club we was in, and we'd walk down Main Street in Payette, just hollering and carrying on, having a good time. And those are the things I'd miss about my brother and my father, because we did have a lot of fun. And my brother, he was more to me than a brother. He was a twin. And I will always miss him for that, because we have a lot of good times together. Thank you.
Anyone else? I can come to you if you'd like. You can just raise your hand.
Okay, so we'll have another musical selection. Are we ready with that? Okay. And then I'll dedicate the grave. I should be thankful, Lord, I know I should.
Lord, I hope this day is good. Lord, have you forgotten me? I've been praying to you faithfully. I'm not saying I'm a righteous man, but Lord, I hope you understand.
Our dear Father in heaven, by the authority of the Melchizedek priesthood, which I hold, I dedicate this grave, this resting spot, the final spot for the body of James and McCullough. May it be protected and hallowed, and may it be a special place for his family to come and to remember. And may his spirit be amongst them to comfort and give them peace, that they'll remember the good things that he has done in their life, and that they are what they are because of the experience of his life. To bless this, to be a memorial and a blessing to those who will visit. We're grateful for his life. We're thankful for all that he meant to us, and we're grateful unto thee for giving us a path across his. And we do this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Folks, this concludes the services for Jim McCullough. We appreciate you for being here. to support the family and their loss. Thank you for being here. Please feel free to talk amongst yourselves and enjoy the nice bright sun today. Thank you.
Kip, some of them have flowers they want to put on them.
If there's any that have flowers and would like to set it on the casket now while he plays the bagpipes, would be a great time.
It's all right. We have plenty. We'll get it. Look out.